Okay, I think we are just about ready here to get started with the program. I know some of you are just getting your dinners, but also know this is always a really busy weekend, busy in a very good way, with a first home football game and knowing that we are really rolling now into another season of Wisconsin Badger athletics. So let's get it started. So before we actually begin the induction ceremony, I'd like to thank the National W Club Hall of Fame Selection Committee, including the Executive Director of the National W Club, Mike Cerniglia. Thank you very much, Michael, your staff. This year we are doing things a little bit differently. As I said a while ago, those of you who have been attendees here through the years, you already know this, but for those who haven't, this is the first year that we have had the ceremony here at Union South. And a couple of other tweaks in the program itself. And the idea is simple. We just want to enhance the program and give you a better idea of the story of this Hall of Fame class. We'll have a video of each of the seven inductees, and then we'll have a little fun, a little question and answer session with each of the attendees in who are here tonight, each of the inductees, who are in attendance here tonight. So with that, let me start by introducing the class of 2015. If you could stand, wave, whatever. You're a Hall of Famer. You can do what you want. Let's start with Paula Bonner from administration. From volleyball, Lizzie Fitzgerald. From soccer, Mike Gentile. From basketball, Devin Harris. From football, Jim Leonard. And from hockey, he's not here tonight because he's coaching his kids down in Florida, but let's give him a nice round of applause. Brian Rafalski. And also from women's hockey, making some more history for that great program, Carrie Weiland. I know we have a number of coaches, both past and present, in the room here tonight. We welcome all of you. And also, if we could have all the past Hall of Fame inductees, if you could please stand and let us recognize you here tonight. All the past inductees, welcome back. I said this is always a busy time of year, but busy in the best kind of way, and I think Coach Alvarez would agree with that, but I want to bring him up here before we begin the induction ceremony. Please welcome now in year 12 as the athletics director at the University of Wisconsin, a Hall of Famer himself, Barry Alvarez.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you very much. I also would like to commend the W Club, Mike Cerniglia, and his staff for tweaking things, making things a little bit better. Bringing us to this venue. For those of you who haven't been around or haven't been to a Hall of Fame induction before, we would have this in front of the stadium in a large tent. And as you know, there are many days in the fall at this time of year where it gets very hot. And my most vivid memory is introducing one of my former players, and he screamed too when I introduced him. Corey Raymer, and it had to be close to 90 degrees, 90% humidity. We had a big barn fan blowing across the tent, and Raymer comes up, and I thought his suit change was a little darker than it was when I saw him earlier, and he came up and hugged me, and he was wringing wet. I mean, wringing wet. I was wet when I left the stage, but what a great venue we have now and an improvement. Thank all of you for coming to honor this year's inductees. This is a special night for us. This is a night that we have the opportunity to honor some of our great athletes and those who have made great contributions to the athletic department. You think of all the athletes. Right now we have nearly 900 athletes. I don't know how many coaches. You think of all of those people, and every year we induct 7. So that's a very, very small percentage. And that's how special this group is, and this truly is a special group. And I congratulate each and every one of you. This is your night. Let's all have a lot of fun and celebrate.
Thank you, Coach. And now on with the show, on with the induction ceremony. And we will begin with Paula Bonner. You know, these days, feel free. It's her night. You know, go ahead and applaud. Absolutely. These days, Paula, when I think of you, I think of someone who is an absolute star, a showstopper at Badger pep rallies. I've had the pleasure of introducing Paula at a number of events, including a couple of pregame functions at Santa Monica Pier. It's a pretty good place to spend New Year's Eve, I might add, or other great venues on the eve of bowl games. And I think it is safe to say there is no alumni association leader anywhere in the country who cares more than Paula. With her enthusiasm, it is absolutely impossible not to be excited about being a Badger. And make no mistake, Paula is a Badger through and through. As we continue to enjoy the growth and the success of women's athletics here, and really for that matter all across the country, it's important to remember Paula's role in making it possible for women's intercollegiate sports not only to exist, but to excel. It was an undertaking built really, you could say literally, from the ground floor. Every aspect of the process was very important, and Paula's versatility and her tireless energy played a vital role in giving young women opportunities that previously had not been possible. Simply put, thanks to individuals such as Paula, not only are the doors open for women's intercollegiate athletics, those sports are now a major part of campus life for the athletes and for the thousands of fans who support them.
Paula Bonner brought her enthusiasm and Southern charm from Monk's Corner, South Carolina, to the University of Wisconsin as a graduate student in 1976. It didn't take long for her to find the fledgling women's intercollegiate athletics program just beginning in Madison, and for Paula to lend her considerable talents to the Badgers. After completing graduate school, Paula became the assistant athletic director under the legendary director of women's athletics, Skit Saunders, also a Hall of Famer. In those days, the small staff wore many hats, and Paula found herself as the event organizer, marketing director, and even dealt with food and beverage, ordering everything from sandwiches to porta potties to make every occasion perfect. But it was Paula's irrepressible spirit and high energy that really made the public take notice of this evolving program. Paula became the director of the women's program in 1983, and with support from the Women's Intercollegiate Sports Booster Club, ushered in an era of success not seen before in women's sports on this campus. Paula teamed with media personality Barbara Wagner to create the weekly Badger Women's Sports Radio Show broadcast. The program ran for several years, showcasing all the women's sports coaches and impact players, and brought statewide attention to the program. Paula's leadership and love of the university didn't go unnoticed by others on campus. It wasn't long before, in 1989, she was tapped to become first the associate executive director and later in 2000, chief executive of the Wisconsin Alumni Association. In her last year in athletics, Wisconsin's 11-sport women's program was ranked 17th best in the country. At the Alumni Association, Paula is recognized for bringing innovation and the alumni voice to programs, services, and communications that are relevant and meaningful to UW-Madison's more than 400,000 alumni. She has worked tirelessly promoting issues of diversity and equal opportunity at the university, and as a member of the Chancellor's Leadership Council, helped oversee advancement for UW-Madison. Long recognized as a leader in the Madison and university community, she served as the national president of the Council of Alumni Association Executives, is a member of the Madison Club and Bascom Hill Society, and was honored with the Madison Civics Club Advocate Award in 1999. Never straying far from her roots, Paula has also continued to be a proud partner with UW Athletics for a variety of bowl and special athletics event alumni activities, where you most likely have seen her lead varsity or a spirited rendition of On Wisconsin. As a sports pioneer and campus leader, Paula's actions have taken this university to new heights, as well as taken Paula to this well-deserved recognition as a member of the UW Athletics Hall of Fame. Congratulations, Paula.
So you don't even want to sit down, do you? You got all that energy.
Could I take over the show now?
You probably could. I'll be back there. I'll just sit back and enjoy. Where'd all that energy come from? You've had it as long as I've known you.
Where does all that energy come from? First of all, I think it comes because of having landed in a great place, the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and being able to really work with and for and together with a whole lot of people, many of them in this room and many, many others who aren't here tonight, who share a passion and a vision and a dream. And if you're going after that, it just builds inside of you. And it's a lot of love and happiness, you know, but you've got to have a serious purpose. And I was thinking when you were going to ask me this, I said, I wanted to say, well, I really get my energy from the Wizard of Oz. And here's why. Because that show, I love it. I know every line of that show. And it's about the scarecrow who wanted a brain, the tin man who wanted a heart, and the lion who wanted courage. And they all had it. And they go on this journey and they find it. So if you can find and work with people who share that capacity of brain, heart, and courage, anything can happen, and it gives you a lot of energy.
Very well stated. When you were such an important person to help start women's intercollegiate athletics, did you dream that it could be at the level where it is today? Because when I introduced the video, I said it's a big part of campus life everywhere. Did you think it could get to where it is today?
If I think seriously without answering it from now, and I think way back then, and during some moments way back then in 78, 79, 80, I particularly was involved in leading the program between 82 and 90, and that was a year. Those were some years where the interpretation of Title IX was going up and down and all over, so that was added to the dimensions of things. So at times I really wasn't sure because Title IX got developed in 1972 and it took at least 15 years before it all kind of started settling in. And so you started thinking at times, can you ever get there? And so I am thrilled today. My hat is off to Cheryl Mara, Terry Golick, Barry, all the people who've come through to just build this up. From the time I left in 1989.
You just partially answered my last question, and everyone is, all the inductees who are here are going to get this opportunity. Others you'd like to thank here along the way.
I knew that was one of the questions, and I've been thinking about that. I'm going to first thank Representative Edith Green from Oregon and Senator Birch Bayh from Indiana, who together constructed one very long sentence that got added as an amendment to the Educational Equal Opportunity, the Title IX legislation. And that launched some opportunities that I just do have to say, we would not be here today without having had that vision and courage from a lot of people, from a lot of points of view who saw the benefit and value. And the importance to the country of girls being able to have those kind of opportunities to be strong, to have self-esteem, to discover, test themselves, so many values that come from participating in athletics. And women hold up half the sky, and they needed that. So I really thank Representative Edith Green and Birch Bayh for that. And then, and look up Edith Green because she's quite a story. And then it's very hard. I have been, so I am very thankful first. I have to take a moment and thank the committee for giving me this honor. I'm so, I'm moved to be with the other six inductees here tonight. My thanks go back from my father to my undergrad college to people here at Wisconsin who helped me get my degree, faculty, staff, fellow coaches, alumni that I love beyond compare, a great staff now at the Alumni Association, great, great friends, people who have what I call Anamkar. They are my soulmates in so many ways. And I've had a lot of friends that I consider Anamkara. And especially thanks to my partner and spouse, Ann Schaefer, for the last 25 years, who's lived with one of the craziest gals on the planet. So, thank you all very much. This is a great honor. This is an incredible university, and this is a fantastic athletic program. I am always proud to go around the country and go around the world and talk about what is accomplished here. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations. Let's do a pep rally together again.
Let's do a pep rally.
December. Let's go. Thank you, Paula. Paula Bonner. Okay, Lizzie, you have to follow that. So, next, we honor one of this university's all-time greats in volleyball, someone who has a fair amount on her plate going on this weekend, of course, a Badger star who is in year number 5 as head coach at the University of Georgia, Lizzie Fitzgerald. She claims she arrived on campus as a, in her words, as the story goes, a clueless freshman. If there's any truth to that, it's safe to say that Lizzie found a clue, and actually she found a lot more than that as she became a star and clearly one of the key ingredients to a team that took control of the Big Ten Conference and very much became a national player with that terrific run to the championship round of the 2000 NCAA tournament. Now you think back to that time, that was a very, very heady time for UW Athletics with Rose Bowl victories, Final Four runs in multiple sports going on during that period. A lot of titles to be celebrated, and make no mistake, Badger volleyball was very much in that mix, and Lizzie Fitzgerald was right in the middle of it all. I would think that every coach wants his or her players to grow in and out of the athletic arena, and that's why Lizzie, who was recruited nationally, I might add, chose the University of Wisconsin, and no doubt she's doing all she can to help her athletes today, and I certainly hope her student-athletes are listening, because Lizzie has been there, and she has done that at a very, very high level. Let us welcome another volleyball legend to the UW Athletics Hall of Fame.
For Lizzie Fitzgerald, coming to Madison from New Orleans was like stepping into another world. Not only was the traveling more than 1,000 miles away from home, but she was coming to the Badgers as one of the top high school setters in the country. Luckily for Fitzgerald, she had time to adjust to the college game as a freshman. She saw only limited playing time as a rookie, playing behind and learning from one of the UW's best, all Big Ten center Colleen Neals. Prior to her sophomore season, Fitzgerald gained experience with the USA Volleyball Collegiate National Team and ended up splitting time as the Badgers' starting setter in her second season. Fitzgerald became the Badgers' starting setter 9 matches into her junior year, a role she would not relinquish until graduation. As a junior, the 6-foot setter made her mark when she was named the National Player of the Week, the first for the Badger program, guiding Wisconsin to 3-0 wins over Penn State and Indiana to open the Big Ten Conference season. UW went on to win the Big Ten Championship with an 18-2 record and qualified for the NCAA tournament. The Badgers hosted first and second rounds of the NCAA tournament, defeating Bucknell and Northern Iowa and earning the right to host an NCAA regional. Wisconsin down 17th-ranked Kansas State in 4 sets in the regional semifinals, setting up a nail-biting 5-set match against 11th-ranked UCLA. Wisconsin won the 5th set 15-12 in an electric field house to advance to its first NCAA national semifinal. In Richmond, Virginia, Wisconsin upset 2nd-ranked USC in 3 straight sets to advance to the title match. Badgers fell to unbeaten and top-ranked Nebraska in 5 sets in the championship, but it was a match that put Wisconsin volleyball on the map. Fitzgerald earned second-team All-America honors as a junior and would return to lead the Badgers for her senior season. Wisconsin won back-to-back Big Ten championships under Fitzgerald, who was named the 2001 Big Ten Player of the Year. She also picked up her second All-America honor. Fitzgerald wrapped up her career ranked third in Wisconsin with 3,890 assists, ranking first all-time with 12.74 assists per set. She also ranked in the top 15 in blocks. Continuing to play after graduation, Fitzgerald was a member of the USA Volleyball training team in 2002 and 2003. In 2002, she won a silver medal at the World Championships, and in 2003, the U.S. won a bronze medal at the Pan American Games. Fitzgerald took her career overseas, playing in Puerto Rico and France for the next 2 years. Her older sister was a volleyball coach, and Fitzgerald followed in her footsteps, becoming an assistant coach at the University of North Carolina once her playing career was done. She then spent 3 seasons as an assistant at the University of Nebraska before becoming the head coach at the University of Georgia in 2011. At Wisconsin, Fitzgerald found her way both on and off the court. She met her future husband, Kevin Stemke, All-American punter on the Badger football team while in school. The two currently have 2 children. For Fitzgerald, volleyball has been her passion, and she plans to pass it on to the next generation of players. Congratulations, Lizzie, on a tremendous career and a deserving honor. Congratulations, Lizzie.
Congratulations. I said I stole the line from a story where you said you were a clueless freshman. Is that an accurate quote? And if it is, what changed? What made you not feel so clueless as you move forward in your athletic career?
Yeah, I didn't realize that particular term would be used quite so literally. But there was no better word. Clueless was exactly the word that I could come up with. And I think first and foremost, my parents really ingrained in me that they were a family that didn't try to bulldoze struggle. Instead, they taught me the tools to embrace struggle and to work through it and to learn that through the struggle is where the gold is. And so, first and foremost, I feel like I was raised to battle, and that comes from my home and from my parents. But as I came to college, that mindset of embracing that struggle and that balance was something that helped with transitioning out of clueless. But certainly opening my eyes and embracing a completely different environment from what I grew up in, and meeting people that were integral in jump-starting my life, and so many people I could go on and on.
Well, we'll get to that. We'll get to the thank you portion. But what can you give us an idea of what the weekend has been like? You mentioned it's your fifth year. You got a very young team at the University of Georgia this year. But coming back home this weekend, you're competing, and yet you're getting a heck of an honor. What's it been like for you?
It's been overwhelming. It's been incredibly humbling. It's been nerve-wracking. And very exciting all in one. It's been a very emotionally charged weekend, that's for sure. As a coach, there's so much that you try to reflect on during your own playing days that can help, that you find a little nugget here and there that can help, these kids get through their own battles and their own struggles. And certainly, my playing career was not smooth, there's a lot to draw from that. So having them here, having them be a part of what was my experience while they're also battling their own struggles day in and day out, was was incredibly invigorating, but also nerve-wracking at the same time. But very cool for them to see, you know, kind of where I grew up, so to speak. And I can only hope that during my time as a coach, I'm an influence to them to battle, to never give up, to fight the good fight, and to enjoy it while you're going through it.
Give you your chance for thank yous. Additional thank yous you would like to pass along?
You know, this... We could go on for hours. I know we all can. First and foremost, I have to, I would be completely remiss if I did not talk about my teammates. And I am under no illusion that I am up here without the people that I played with. Very, very special group, and people that challenged me personally, challenged me on the court. But we're also loving support to take risks and to go after it and to dream a big dream. So my team, during my time here, each and every year, is more to credit here than any of those statistics. You know, Pete Waite is in the house, which, you know, he did an unbelievable job here at Wisconsin, and I'm really thankful that he is here and thankful for my time with him. John Cook had recruited me here, thankful for his mentorship. All the other coaches that were a part of my time, they all taught me something, and I've tried to soak in every piece of every experience from all of those wonderful coaches. I cannot go without thanking the W Club for just an unbelievable effort in putting this week together. I know so many logistics with our Georgia team playing here this weekend and putting all of this together, and the communication was fantastic. The attention to detail was unbelievable for Coach Alvarez and Coach Sheffield. For pushing this to happen, you know, and combine my two worlds is something I will never forget. And then, of course, my family, my husband Kevin Stemke was and is more of an athlete and supporter than I could ever have dreamed. He's supported everything that I've done and given me such a wonderful family and a wonderful home to come to each and every night. My parents could not be here tonight, and their unwavering support through good, bad, ugly is something that I am incredibly blessed to have. My in-laws are here. They are just as supportive as the son they raised. My friends, my family, everyone in this room for being a part of this night. This weekend as a whole, even though our team struggled quite a bit this weekend, this weekend as a whole is something that, you know, the University of Wisconsin is absolutely a special place. And I can only hope that, the players that I coach and mentor, feel as proud of their alma maters as I do each and every day. And this experience as a whole has been truly amazing. And I thank everyone for being a part of it.
It's been a whirlwind week, to say the least. I'm not telling you anything. You don't know. You're living it. But I hope you can enjoy all of this. Congratulations. Very well deserved. Hall of Fame.
Thank you. Thank you.
Lizzie Fitzgerald. Yeah, Kevin's an okay guy. A chance to talk to him. Chance to cover him. One of the great punters at this university. It's good to see you. And very well deserved, Lizzie. Congratulations. Up next, we turn to soccer and Mike Gentile. Barry Alvarez has often talked about how much he enjoys making the phone calls to inform those who will be inducted into the Hall of Fame. And In a recent interview with Mike Lucas for Varsity Magazine, Mike Gentile admits that when he got the call, he thought it was a prank phone call because, by his own admission, Mr. Gentile has been known to pull a joke or two on some of his friends. But I'm guessing Mike isn't the only Hall of Famer to think that there was a joke being played on him. But in fact, this was no joke. I think it would be safe to assume that there was absolutely no laughing from Badger opponents as Mike Gentile and his teammates became soccer's national champions back in 1995. From just outside Detroit, Michigan, Mike had a pleasant problem coming out of high school. Choose between two fine academic institutions, Wisconsin, and if you'll pardon me, Duke. Luckily for the Badgers, Mike said no to Duke and said yes to the University of Wisconsin. During his time, Wisconsin gained ample experience in the NCAA tournament. Coach Jim Launder was clearly building something special here, and Mike recognized that and went about the business of helping this program achieve the ultimate dream. And that's exactly what happened for the Badgers that season, a season where shutouts were most definitely the rule and not the exception. It's been a while since Mike's had the opportunity to come back this way. Professional careers and children who are playing the game can keep Dad pretty busy. But he's back tonight with plans to return in a couple of weeks for that 20-year national championship reunion. Certainly known as a team player, but these next few minutes belong to Mike Gentile and his Hall of Fame induction.
Immense talent and invaluable leader during his collegiate soccer career at the University of Wisconsin, Mike Gentile remains one of the most decorated Badgers in school history. Not only did Gentile become an All-American as a senior, he was an All-Region and All-Big Ten performer with poise and leadership on the field that helped lead the Badgers to a national championship. Recognized as a third-team All-American in 1995 by the National Soccer Coaches Association of America, Gentile is one of only seven Badgers to earn All-America distinction in program history. Over the course of his collegiate career from 1992 to 1995, the UW midfielder was a two-time All-Midwest Region team member and earned first-team All-Big Ten honors three times and second-team accolades once. The Badgers made the NCAA tournament three times with Gentile on the roster in Madison, including the program's most memorable season in 1995. With Gentile serving as team captain and leading the team in scoring, Wisconsin posted a 15-4-1 regular season record and laid claim to the Big Ten Conference regular season title to set up a magical NCAA tournament run. During its entire run through the 1995 NCAA tournament, Wisconsin did not concede a single goal, posting shutout wins against Bowling Green, William & Mary, SMU, and Portland to set up a meeting with Duke in the national championship game. On December 10th, at the University of Richmond, the unseeded Badgers and unseeded Blue Devils met for NCAA men's soccer supremacy. Behind the leadership of Gentile, stingy defense from the Badgers, and goals from Lars Hansen and Chad Cole, Wisconsin came out on top 2-0 and claimed the first national title in Wisconsin men's soccer history. Gentile finished his illustrious career in Madison with 16 goals and 21 assists for 53 points, ranking 6th in school history in career assists and 9th in career points. He's also tied for 4th in program annals for assists in a season with 11 during UW's national championship campaign. One of the bright young talents in soccer, Gentile was selected for the roster of the United States under-20 men's national team that played in the 1993 FIFA World Youth Championship. Following his collegiate career, Gentile was drafted in the 1996 Major League Soccer College Draft by the Colorado Rapids, selected 9th overall in the first round. He later signed with the Milwaukee Rampage of the United States Interregional Soccer League, and in 1997, the Rampage and Gentile won the league championship. Won another USISL league title with the Minnesota Thunder in 1999. In 2000, Gentile was drafted by an MLS team for the second time in his professional career when the Tampa Bay Mutiny selected him in the 6th round of the MLS Super Draft. An All-American and national champion at Wisconsin and a true professional both on and off the field, Mike Gentile rightfully takes his place as a member of the Wisconsin Athletic Hall of Fame's class of 2015. Congratulations, Mike.
Congratulations. So you really thought it was a prank phone call? Someone was playing a joke on you?
I did. I pranked a friend of mine as far as sending letters to Canada to have them sent back and told me this part of the NHL and scouting bureau. And so when I got the call, I was like, there's no way that this is possible. And thank you to Michelle Ballweg for assuring me that it was not a prank.
It was for real.
Oh, it was for real.
That 95 team, did you feel like, I mean, the way you guys were shutting people out with regularity, did you just have that feel that one goal was going to be enough almost every time out?
First, can I just say, did you see the hair?
I did. I wasn't going to comment on that.
It was awesome. It was awesome.
Those were the days, right?
You know, that 95 team was something magical, and it's something that I say to everybody in sports. It's really hard to put into words when a team has the chemistry and gels. And you talk about it, you know, and you have teams that have great players on it, and you have teams that work hard. But that team, once we got into the playoffs, and we had a really good season, but once we got into the playoffs, the chemistry was just right.
You mentioned that you haven't had too many chances to come back to Madison. Life kind of takes people a different direction. Have you been in touch, though? Have you been able to keep in touch with you? I know you're going to have a chance to get together with them again here soon, but have you had a chance to just through the years just stay in touch with those guys?
There's a few guys, especially through Facebook and social media, that, you know, everybody goes on to do their own thing, and some guys you follow who continue on in sports and different teams. And so there's some guys that live with me in Minneapolis, and so that's great. I'm so excited to come back here in 2 weeks and revisit those glory days, and I'm just so excited to be here.
Time for the thank yous. This is probably the hardest question, by the way. I should point that out, and the inductees certainly understand that, but time for your shout out.
Well, you know, and first, again, I wanted to thank Michelle for doing such an amazing job and again, reassuring me that this was for real, because I wasn't going to come. So thank you for that. I want to thank my two heroes in life, my mom and dad, who are sitting right here in front of me. I think for a majority of us, we have people that support us and love us unconditionally, and they're the two best people in the world, and I would not be here without them, and I love them so much, and so thank you for all of your support, good and bad times throughout my life. So I appreciate that. I want to thank my teammates. I mean, this is an award that I want to accept on behalf of my teammates. I don't think any of us would be here without the passion and the strength and the friendships that we have. And everybody on that team has to be at their best, especially in that 95 season. But if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be up here today. So I want to accept that on behalf of my teammates. I want to thank my roommate, Josh Provon, for having a psycho cat when we roomed together. And that's why I don't have cats today. So thanks, Josh, for that. I appreciate that. I want to thank my family that's also supported me and allowed me to watch soccer every Sunday. My son Marco and my daughter Olivia and my wife Monica. Great support. And I also just want to say that I'm really honored to be involved with the caliber of athletes that are being inducted today. I was reading everybody's bios and just such an amazing group of people, and very proud to be a part of it.
Well, and it was a magical ride 20 years ago, but your career was pretty magical. You're very deserving. Congratulations. Enjoy this weekend, and enjoy it a couple of weeks when you're right back here. It's a big month for you.
Thank you, and you saw we beat Duke in the final, right?
Exactly right. Nicely done.
Congratulations.
Mike Gentile. Next up is Devin Harris. No, Coach Bo Ryan loves to tell a story about Devin when he was here early on in his career as a Badger. Like many, Devin was making the adjustments from high school standout to someone trying to earn playing time at the collegiate level. Meanwhile, Coach Ryan was establishing to Devin and everyone else on the team how it worked around here. The Badgers keep track of everything in every practice. So as Bo tells a story, after one of those practices, Devin came up to Coach Ryan and said, "So, Coach, do you mean that we have to go hard every day, including practice?" And Bo was, as you can imagine, "Yeah, Devin, you do." And Devin quickly understood that every practice, every drill, every video session mattered. And man, oh, man, did Devin Harris ever matter for the Wisconsin Badgers. Big Ten Player of the Year, All-American, part of a two-time conference champion.
he could quite simply take over a basketball game and be particularly dangerous in the clutch. From a game-winning free throw to secure an outright Big Ten title, to what I still think is one of the biggest assists in Wisconsin Badger basketball history when he set up Freddie Owens for a game-winning three-point shot to cap an incredible comeback against Tulsa in the NCAA tournament. You name it, Devin Harris could do it. By the way, he guards you really tightly as well. If you're making a list of the Badgers' greatest basketball players ever, Devin Harris absolutely has to be on it. And tonight, Devin officially becomes part of the greatest athletes this university has ever known. Devin Harris.
A few years after being hired as the head coach at Wisconsin, Bo Ryan and his wife Kelly were able to build their dream house on the far west side of the Madison area. To visitors, Ryan would often joke that it was the house that Devin built. While the head coach certainly played a role in the Badgers' early success, no one was more pivotal to the program's renaissance than point guard Devin Harris. Harris piloted the Badgers to a Big Ten championship in each of his three seasons at UW, including back-to-back regular season titles in 2002 and 2003, the school's first conference championship since 1947. A starter in all 96 games of his collegiate career, the Wauwatosa, Wisconsin native averaged 35 minutes per game. Despite playing just three seasons, Harris tallied 1,425 career points, which ranked as the seventh highest total in Badgers history. The only freshman to start a season opener under Bo Ryan, Harris burst onto the scene, averaging 12.3 points per game in his first season in Madison. His production would increase as a sophomore, and he also made one of the most iconic shots in recent memory. Harris knocked down the game-winning free throw with just 0.4 of a second remaining to give Wisconsin a 60-59 win over Illinois and its first outright Big Ten title in 56 years. A few weeks later, Harris would help UW reach the 2003 Sweet 16. Something unseen in Madison since the 1940s. As a junior in 2004, the lightning-quick point guard with deep range would put together one of the greatest seasons in school history. Averaging 19.4 points per game, Harris became the Badgers' first Big Ten Player of the Year since Don Rehfeld in 1950. He also took home Wooden Award All-American honors and was named second-team All-American by the Associated Press. In a season that culminated with the Badgers' first-ever Big Ten Tournament Championship, Harris set a Wisconsin school record with 97 points over a three-game span, highlighted by a career-high 38-point masterpiece versus Minnesota. Declaring early for the NBA, Harris was selected fifth overall in the 2004 draft and has enjoyed a decorated professional career. Entering his 12th season in the NBA in 2015-16, Harris has appeared in more than 700 games with Dallas, New Jersey, Utah, and Atlanta. In just his second year in the NBA, Harris played an integral role in the Mavericks' run to the 2006 NBA Finals. The 2008 trade sent Harris to the New Jersey Nets, where his career reached a new level. He scored 21 points in 21 minutes during his debut, foreshadowing the big production to come. Harris was selected to the 2009 NBA All-Star Game after averaging 21.3 points per game, punctuated by a career-high 47 points against the Pistons. After stints with the Jazz and Hawks, Harris, along with his wife Megan and daughters Charlie and Scarlett, is back in Dallas, where his pro career began with the Mavericks. The Badger great is looking to add to career totals that have already seen him tally more than 9,000 points and 3,500 assists. One of the principal architects of the Badgers' 21st century dominance, Devin Harris takes his rightful place in the Wisconsin Athletic Hall of Fame. Congratulations, Devin.
Got to ask you, that was some fun highlight clips. How are your ups? Can you still dunk like that?
I haven't dunked like that since 2004.
The free throw that we saw, that was the second. That was the outright Big Ten title. But the previous year, you shared it. But that was a season where I think it's safe to say the expectations weren't real high. You guys had a tough schedule early. When did you feel like that year started to gel?
Well, it was tough on us early on. I mean, we came into a situation, we had a new coach, a ton of new players, a new system that nobody's ever played before. Seniors who had previous success, and you know, we didn't start out the year really that well. But it, coach Ryan always installed persistence with us, and that team was more persistent than anything else. And as the year went on, we got better and better. And, you know, we hit our stride at the right time. We had great, senior leadership, Javon Davis, Charlie Wills. Those guys really kept after us and didn't let us quit. And, we did great things.
It was a tremendous season. I mentioned what I thought, and you've probably heard me say this before, what my favorite moment of watching you. And you've had the electrifying scoring spree against Minnesota and so many other games. But I still think of that assist when you set up Freddie out in Spokane. But let me turn it to you. What if you were to pick one moment in your time as a Badger, what would it be?
I got to say, winning that first conference championship. Coming into the year, I think we were picked to finish last. And I think it was right after the whole scandal that we had. And we didn't have any scholarships, had a lot of walk-on players. And coming with a new coach with a not-so-favorable system, we kind of hated the system. But... we kept after it, and to be able to win, a conference championship when, expectations are very low is something very gratifying.
Yeah, that was, for those who weren't here, I think that was a year that people were wondering if they could win 10 games, period, and ended up winning a piece of the Big Ten championship. Been in the league for a while now. Has it gone quickly?
It's gone very quickly. Just every year we get a new set of rookies coming in, and it makes you feel a lot older than what you really are. I'm old in NBA years, but not in life. But it's just... just got to keep trucking, and I love doing it. I love what it's done for me and the family, and hopefully I can continue to play as long as I can.
All right, the final question, the tough one, the thank yous. Who would you like to thank?
First off, I'd like to thank my parents. My dad is here tonight. He pushed me so hard to the point that we can't even talk about basketball anymore. But without him, I wouldn't be here. I would say I had childhood friends who really kept me on the straight and narrow, even when they decided not to stay on the straight and narrow. They've been great for me growing up. Gail, who's been a trainer at my high school, she kind of took me under her wing very early on and taught me things that I didn't know were possible and really installed a work ethic in me that I didn't know I had. Coaches along the way, some who've been positive and really installed thought I was better than actually than I was, and coaches that told me that I wasn't better than I was and kind of motivated me. So both those kind of things. My wife and my kids, they're my heart. I love them. Even though I'm in a house full of all girls, they're still great.
You have no chance in that.
I got no chance. Tiffany, who's been with me since I joined the NBA and really helps me with things like this, speaking engagements, which I really don't enjoy doing, but she, really encouraged me to speak my heart and speak from the mind. And, everybody being here tonight celebrating this great event. Coach Alvarez for giving me the call and thinking I'm worthy. And just glad to be here tonight and being able to celebrate with the other inductees.
Welcome home. Congratulations. Well deserved. Devin Harris. Congratulations, Devin. Now on to Jim Leonard. It was in the first week or so of training camp when Jim was starting his career as a Badger. Barry Alvarez, I'm not even sure if Coach remembers this, but he's answering routine questions after a training camp, a post-practice media session. Then without anybody asking him about Jim specifically, Barry mentioned a young man named Jim Leonard. Well, the reporters there at the time kind of looked at each other and shrugging her shoulders. Most really didn't have a real strong idea who Barry was talking about, nor did they have the first clue where we would find Jim's hometown on a map. But a few days later, in another post-practice media session, Barry brought up the name again, saying, "I'm telling you guys, this Jimmy Leonard can play. He's serious." No doubt many thought this might have been Barry's way of deflecting attention from the usual Q&A about the quarterback position or why so-and-so didn't practice, who's hurt, who's not, whatever the case. But Barry was very serious in talking about Jim, and he was also spot on. The walk-on tradition with the Badger football program is real, and it's really good. Jim Leonard became really good in a hurry, and then he became great. From walk-on to All-American to a decade-long NFL career, as one of the league's most respected players. Little Jimmy Leonard wasn't so little anymore. And when you're introduced at Jets home games as the quarterback of the defense, as Jim was in his time with the Jets, that gives you an idea of his value. But we here at Wisconsin, we knew all about Jim Leonard's value. That's why he's a Hall of Famer, and very deservedly so. Jim Leonard.
Growing up in tiny Tony, Wisconsin, Jim Leonard was a local star as a three-sport athlete at Flambeau High School. The son of a basketball and baseball coach, Leonard excelled both on the court and diamond. As a point guard, he once made 10 three-pointers in a single half, and on the mound, he once struck out 19 of 21 batters in a single game. But it was on the gridiron where Leonard would see his greatest success. Head coach Barry Alvarez offered Leonard a walk-on spot for the 2001 Badgers, and the undersized safety quickly made his presence felt. He appeared in all 12 games that first year, recording 12 tackles on special teams. Not bad for a true freshman, but few could have expected what was to come. Leonard burst onto the national scene as a sophomore, picking off two passes in his first career start to help lead the Badgers to a 23-21 win over Fresno State. He would go on to earn first-team All-America honors, leading the nation and tying a Big Ten record with 11 interceptions. He also made his mark on special teams, ranking second in the Big Ten and setting a school record for punt return yardage. The following season, Leonard proved those numbers were no fluke, again being named a first-team All-American. He led the Big Ten once again with 8 interceptions, including a key fourth-quarter pick in Wisconsin's 17-10 upset of third-ranked Ohio State, and tied for the team lead with 98 tackles. He also returned 2 punts for touchdowns and broke his own school record with 470 punt return yards. As a senior, Leonard again earned first-team All-America honors and was a finalist for the inaugural Lott Impact Trophy. He finished his career with 21 interceptions, tying Jamar Fletcher's school record. He also broke the Big Ten record with 1,347 career punt return yards, a mark that currently ranks second in league annals. As accomplished as he was on the field, Leonard excelled in the classroom as well. A 2-time academic All-American, he joined Alan Ameche, Dave Mohab, and Don Davey as the only Badgers to earn that distinction multiple times. He was also one of 15 players nationally to earn a postgraduate scholarship from the National Football Foundation in 2004. Following his days as a Badger, Leonard again beat the odds, earning a spot on the Buffalo Bills' 53-man roster after signing as an undrafted free agent. He spent 3 seasons with the Bills, playing in 38 games. Leonard got his big break in 2008 after signing with the Baltimore Ravens. Following an injury to DeJuan Landry, he started 16 of Baltimore's final 17 games, including all 3 in the playoffs. He signed with the New York Jets the following season and started 40 games over the next 3 seasons. He then played for the Denver Broncos in 2012 and the Bills again in 2013 before retiring following the 2014 season with the Cleveland Browns. Leonard, who now lives in Madison with his wife Katie and 2 sons Reese and Graham, played in 142 games over his 10-year NFL career, starting 73 of them. He made 14 career interceptions and averaged 9.2 yards per punt return. A 3-time All-American and a 10-year NFL veteran on the field, a 2-time academic All-American off the field, Jim Leonard is truly a deserving member of the Wisconsin Athletic Hall of Fame's class of 2015. Congratulations, Jim.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
So how did everybody miss, man? I mean, it worked out fine here, but how did everybody not know where Tony Wisconsin was and knew all about Jimmy Leonard?
I'm still trying to figure that one out. Maybe Coach can get up and help me. How you miss a 5'8", 170-pound kid out of a town of 105, that's just beyond me.
Stunning.
But it's been an amazing journey.
Told the story, and again, I don't know, quite frankly, if Barry remembers mentioning you by name without being asked. Was it fairly quickly in that training camp that, like, yeah, I do belong here. I can get on the field sooner than later.
I always had that confidence and knowing the tradition of the walk-ons here, I always felt like if I did what I was supposed to, I was going to get that chance. And I did realize early on that I did belong at this level, and thought I could have some success, and fortunately it worked out that way.
As you said at the end of the video, you're back here with your family in Madison. A terrific year in the NFL. But what do you miss most about the college game, being a college athlete?
Man, it's just the energy, the passion. you know, especially playing here, you get spoiled because the Badgers really bring together not only this whole city, but this whole state. And it's so exciting, and it's hard to recreate that. I mean, Devin can speak on it. Professional sports is a little bit different, and it's not every place is not Green Bay, where you sell out practices and scrimmages, and you just never quite have that same energy. The only thing that's close is playing in the playoffs and playing really big games, and you know, you really do miss that about college, and just being back in the city, there's so much energy on a day-to-day basis, you know, whether there's sports or not involved, but then you add games on top of it, and it's special.
You seem to love the game so much. Is staying involved, I know you've had the camps or camps for a while, teaching it, is that something you want to continue to do here through the years?
Absolutely. I know I don't want to get too far away from the game. I'm not sure exactly in what capacity I want to get back into it, but it means so much to me and the lessons I've learned from it, and I just want to pass on the knowledge I have and help people, help young kids that maybe don't have the support system that I had and the role models and the leaders that were around me. It's amazing what can happen if people find that, and I know I want to be that for a number of kids.
Hey, the final one, the tough one, the thank yous. Who would you like to thank?
Well, first of all, thank you, Lizzie. You made half of my table cry when you started your thank yous, so it took a lot of pressure off of me. But I want to start with my wife, Katie, a fellow alumni as well, and our two little boys, Reese and Graham. They're great, and they're the reason I get up every day, and I love it. And my family, you know, I could have filled up this whole room easily if I would have let them. We had a lot of requests to get in here, but this is a group that's been here forever. And you know, my parents, my brothers, Nancy, Chuck and Lisa, Father John, you guys have been here the whole journey, and I've been so fortunate to have that support system from the time that I started all the way until now, and it means so much. You know, my teammates, obviously, I think I'm the first one from my class, my four classes that's in, and to represent that, it means so much because they're my heroes. You know, they're the reason I went out every day and did what I did. And Coach Alvarez to just give me an opportunity, a fair opportunity, and the rest of the coaching staff, it means so much. The committee for letting me get in this thing, I don't know how it worked out, but so many people I could thank. I'll stop there, but there's so many people, and they know, hopefully they know who they are that's helped along this journey.
You earned this. They let you in, but you earned this. So congratulations. Have a great weekend. Enjoy, Jeff.
Congrats.
Jim Leonard. Up next is Brian Rafalski, and again, I remind you that he is unable to be with us here tonight. He's coaching his son Matthew's youth hockey team down in Southwest Florida. But let us proceed, because he's one terrific athlete and very well deserving of being a part of this 2015 class. And throughout the rich history of UW athletics, there have been those who seemingly have defied the odds and have gone on to enjoy great careers. And Brian Rafalski is another athlete who fits into that category. To some, perhaps he wasn't quite big enough. At least at first, that was the thought of some people. But the truth is, Brian made himself into a physically strong hockey player, one who was very smart and one who could move on the ice with the best of them. His commitment to the game was never in question. Growing up near the NHL city known as Hockey Town, then becoming a star at the tradition-rich program here at the University of Wisconsin. And eventually, it was on to the National Hockey League, where Brian Rafalski learned all about performing and excelling on the biggest stages in the game. His ability to stay on an even keel served him very well as a Badger, and certainly later in his hockey career. And as it turned out, Brian went on to a terrific professional career where he was able to live a dream. In fact, as we're about to see, it might have been even better than he had ever dreamed. And with that, let's take a look at UW Athletic Hall of Famer Brian Rafalski.
Dig through the archives in the Wisconsin Athletic Department, you'll find a questionnaire filled out by Brian Rafalski in 1994 when he was still a student at the university. One question asked, if I could attend a sporting event, it would be? Rafalski's answer, Stanley Cup Finals in Detroit. That is not surprising, given the defenseman grew up playing hockey in Allen Park, located just outside Detroit in hockey-crazed Michigan. Turns out he was a Sear. He attended the 2008 Stanley Cup Finals in Detroit, skating on the Joe Louis Arena ice and helping his hometown Red Wings win the Stanley Cup. It was the last of three cups he would raise in a career that included many doubts along the way from those who were supposed to know what it took. Rafalski was always considered undersized, but that all seems silly now. As he wrote on that same questionnaire, quote, "It doesn't matter how big you are, just what is in your heart." Growing up, his parents Harry and Angie took him all over North America to play in tournaments, and then the game took him to Madison when he was just 16. He played for the first version of the USHL's Madison Capitals. UW coaches Jeff Sauer and Mike Kemp noticed the fleet-footed and heady player. Joining the Badgers a year later, he showed signs of what was to come, winning the first of two Dr. Joseph Coyne Most Consistent Player Awards as a freshman and notching an overtime game winner in the WCHA playoffs along the way to the team's NCAA championship game appearance in 1992. That same year, he helped the U.S. junior team win bronze at the World Junior Championship in Germany for the start of what was a spectacular international career playing for Team USA. He returned to the junior team in 1993, this time with a trip to Sweden, and was selected as one of the team's top three players in the tournament. His junior year at Wisconsin saw the birth of the College Hockey Showcase in Auburn Hills, Michigan, and Rafalski shined, grabbing the team's tournament MVP award in his home state. He earned honorable mention all WCHA recognition that season as well. It was his senior season of 1994-95 when Rafalski took off. The first team All-American showed off his offensive talents by leading WCHA defensemen with a 45-point season and the entire league with 34 assists. That helped him win the 1995 WCHA Defensive Player of the Year honor, as well as the Spike Carlson Team MVP award. He also helped the Badgers capture the 1995 WCHA playoff title along the way, finishing his UW career with 100 points in 150 career games. Undrafted, all of those stats and awards were not enough to catch the eye of an NHL franchise, so Rafalski traveled overseas to play in Sweden and Finland. He spent the next 4 years there and earned the respect of his peers to become the first non-Finnish skater voted the Finnish Elite League's top player. In 1999, Rafalski was named the best hockey player in the world not playing in the NHL by the Sporting News, and the NHL finally came calling. The defenseman signed with the New Jersey Devils, who went on to win the Stanley Cup in a rookie season that included a spot on the league's all-rookie squad. He won again with the Devils in 2003. His NHL run included three selections to All-Star games. It also led back to hometown Detroit, where he would finish his NHL career in 2011, but not until two Stanley Cup final appearances, including that 2008 title. During his career, he played on the 1995 and 1998 U.S. World Championship teams and on the 2002, 2006, and 2010 U.S. Olympic teams, capturing a pair of silver medals. While playing for the 2010 team, he was alternate captain and was named defenseman of the tournament as the top-scoring blue liner. Rafalski, who now lives in Florida with his wife Felicity and sons Daniel, Evan, and Matthew, played in 998 games over an 11-year NHL career that ended five times in the Stanley Cup Finals and all 11 times in the Stanley Cup Playoffs. Including the regular season and the postseason, he scored 109 goals, 507 assists, and 616 points. Already inducted into the U.S. Hockey Hall of Fame in 2014 as one of the top 10 scoring American defensemen in NHL history, Brian Rafalski joins the Wisconsin Athletic Hall of Fame as part of the class of 2015. Congratulations, Brian.
Brian Rafalski. And our final inductee tonight, we're doing this in alphabetical order, by the way, and this is perfect because there's more history here with our final inductee of the night, Kerry Weiland. When you think about the success of the University of Wisconsin women's hockey team, it's fascinating to keep in mind that as a program, it is still relatively young. It's young, but the history is already incredibly rich. And tonight we recognize an athlete who had a major role in making Badger women's hockey what it is today. Kerry Weiland. It was 16 years ago when Coach Julie Sassner made the move from Cornell to start the Badgers program. Now, at first, Kerry admits to not knowing a whole lot about this university, but fortunately, Carrie knew about the coach and quickly discovered that being here in Madison and being a Wisconsin Badger was going to be a terrific fit. She was a standout at every level, from high school in Alaska to here at Wisconsin and on the international stage. That's how it works for a student athlete who also earned degrees in legal studies and sociology. Simply put, Carrie Weiland helps set a very high standard here, both on and off the ice, and is a proud part of the success story that is Wisconsin Badgers women's hockey. And tonight we celebrate another first in this championship-caliber program. Carrie Weiland.
Native of Palmer, Alaska, Carrie Weiland was a trailblazer in the hockey community in Alaska, becoming the first girl to earn first-team All-Region accolades in Alaska prep hockey history. Weiland earned the respect of the Palmer's boys hockey team, serving as the squad's assistant captain as a junior before becoming the team's captain her senior season. Weiland continued to make history when she arrived in Madison in 1999 as a member of the Badgers' first recruiting class after women's hockey was elevated from the club level to varsity at Wisconsin. During the program's first season, Weiland scored 10 goals and 25 assists and earned second-team All-WCHA honors. As a sophomore, Weiland enjoyed a breakout season, leading the country in blue line scoring with 49 points. That still stands as UW's single-season scoring record by a defenseman. Her 37 assists during the 2001 season ranked second among all players in the country and led the WCHA. She collected second-team All-America honors along with first-team All-WCHA accolades. The following year, Weiland made history yet again, becoming the first Badger to earn first-team All-America honors. As an assistant captain, she helped Wisconsin tie for second in the WCHA standings and led the Badgers to the WCHA Women's Final Five title game. Weiland tallied 18 points as a senior to help the Badgers earn a 22-8-5 record under new coach Mark Johnson. The ice wasn't the only place Weiland excelled, as she also found success in the classroom. Weiland was the first UW women's hockey player named to the academic all-district at-large team and was a UW athletic board scholar her junior year. She was an academic all-WCHA selection three times in her career, while she earned academic all-Big Ten honors twice. A four-time all-WCHA honoree, Weiland ended her career as Wisconsin's second leading scorer among defensemen and currently ranks 14th among all players with 124 points. Her 90 career assists are the most by a UW defenseman and ranked 9th among all players in school history. Weiland shined on the international level as well, representing the United States at 5 4 Nations Cups and 4 World Championships, helping the U.S. win gold at the 2008 and 2009 World Championships. She represented her country at the 2010 Winter Olympics in Vancouver, where Weiland and 6 other Badgers helped the U.S. capture silver under the direction of Coach Johnson. In addition, Weiland suited up for Team USA at 4 Women's World Inline Hockey Championships. Weiland, nicknamed Monkey for her head dives over the boards on changeovers while playing prep hockey, now lives in Toronto with her wife, Christina Swabara, and their 3 children. Since Weiland graduated in 2003, the Badgers have won 4 NCAA titles, 5 WCHA playoff championships, and 4 regular season titles. Without Weiland and the rest of the pioneers from the inaugural UW Women's Hockey team, none of the Badgers' current success would be possible. The first All-American in UW women's hockey history, Carrie Weiland opens the door for future UW women's hockey players as a member of the Wisconsin Athletic Hall of Fame's class of 2015. Congratulations, Carrie.
Absolutely. Congratulations. This is history. You are the first from the women's hockey program. How's that feel?
Well, let me first start off with, I had to bring my cheat sheet because at home I hang out with our 3 children that are 3 and under, and I don't normally do any public speaking, more of a referee, so they don't pull each other's hair out. So please excuse my cheat sheets. But it's an honor to be here, first off, with the class. And also, I just wanted to say that, first off. It's just, I've got goosebumps watching each and every one of you fellow inductees. And I just want you to know that it means so much to be here. And as the first women's hockey player, there's been so many since our first class. It's just truly, truly a beautiful thing to be recognized as a UW athlete, and not only as a UW athlete, but a women's hockey player. So I'm just taking a deep breath and soaking it all in.
Absolutely. You're among friends. Yeah, don't worry about the cheat sheet. You're among friends in here. What made Wisconsin, the University of Wisconsin, a terrific fit for you, coming from where you came from?
For me, when I was offered the chance and the opportunity to fly in from Alaska, as soon as I stepped off the plane, I could feel the energy of the city. Madison just has a feeling, a vibe, and I wanted to be a part of it for 4 to 5 years. And so as a small-town farm girl from Alaska, I'm sure that the surrounding farmland spoke to me as well. And I decided that this is where I wanted to put my skates on for the next 4 years.
I asked Paula a while ago about what she thought about women's sports in general, if it would grow, if she thought at the time it would grow to what it is today. Let me ask you a question specific to women's hockey. When you first came on this campus, and now knowing the championships and the tradition that's been built here, excuse me, did you see that when you first got here?
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
Predicted it right away?
Oh yeah. We knew that Wisconsin, the campus, the athletic department could grow a women's hockey program. And I'm sure all of my teammates over there and that are here to celebrate with me can agree that without a doubt, we knew that this could be a place that many, many banners could hang from the ceiling, which they are now. But we first needed a foundation. We had to lay a foundation for the program now. And I tell a story sometimes to just give you an idea of 1999. We actually dressed in the in Camp Randall. We're hockey players. We're dressing in Camp Randall, so we'd arrive at Camp Randall Stadium, and we would, and I'm not complaining, but just to give you an idea of where the program has gone from previous to now, we would walk up the stairs and find the visiting football locker room. Probably never been in it, right, Jim? Yeah, you should never go. It's not a great place. And we would dress, we would find the equipment manager and our trainer shoved in about an 8x8 hole. And we would, that's where we would tape our sticks or where we were supposed to get taped or receive treatment. And then we'd go in the football locker room, the visiting football locker room, no couches or TVs or anything, and we would get halfway dressed, and then we would make the trek halfway with the rest of our gear on our shoulder, 10 minutes to the shell. So we would walk all the way down to the far end of Camp Randall, down the stairs, out of the stadium, through the snow, ice, and anything other elements that were there, and we would go into the shell, which is a public area. We'd find a locker room that could not house the entire team. So we'd split into two teams. Half of us, it was freezing. We would go in there, take our gear out, put our skates on, put the rest of your gear on your helmet, and then jump on the ice. After practice, we'd do this, obviously, we'd dress down, we'd carry our gear back, make the trek back up to the ice. So in those early days, did we dream of a LeBron or a few national championships? Oh, definitely. But first, we had to lay the foundation. The program had to evolve from what it was to what it is today. So I actually took a tour of LeBron, and the things that they walk by, if you ever get a chance to see the women's hockey locker room, they walk by like a cot and cold tub, a movie theater, a beautiful locker room with like a hockey rink on the floor. They've got it. And my hat's off to the University of Wisconsin-Madison for making it a first-class program. But as I will say, and I'm speaking on behalf of my inaugural class, we are so proud to have been a part of the very first class and to be a part and all those memories of trekking. Because the girls now, today, they don't have to do it, but they will never have those bonding experiences of running back through the Camp Randall when you forget your hockey stick And all of a sudden, you're on the ice, and you're going, oh, my God. And you've got to take your skates back off and run all the way through. But you don't need warm-ups when you get back. Definitely, I didn't need a warm-up. So I see it as a powerhouse, and I'm sure there's many, many more championships to come. So it's definitely a team effort.
I think Barry's going to save that clip, because we often talk about what the facilities and the improvements that have been made over the last really 25 years. They're pretty good now, don't they? They
are real good. I mean, I've been in some NHL arenas and facilities, and Mr. Alvarez and your staff have done a beautiful, beautiful job, because my draw, I think I'm still trying to find how to bring it back up off the floor. I mean, the Olympic team, I told Coach Johnson this evening that when he was with the Olympic team, when we traveled, and when we were actually stationed in Minneapolis, he was roughing it. He was roughing it. So, yeah, you got it good here.
Final one for you. I want to give you your opportunity to express your thank yous.
Well, this is where I'm going to pull out my cheat sheet.
Absolutely.
And I actually have a few more to add to it, because now I know of a kind and brilliant woman named Paula Bonner. And, yeah. And that brings me to the fact that I would not be sitting here today, and I know it, and a whole group of people over there would not be sitting here tonight without the people who are behind the scenes, like Paula Bonner, that were striving and could see that there was so much potential left in bringing more student athletes that were female to the collegiate level. And I thank you again, Paula, and even the great sociology professor, Jane Piliavin, who I know was also an advocate and an instrumental person in bringing women's hockey to UW. And I'm sure countless others. So if you were there and you were pushing for UW women's hockey, I thank you. And to bring it to my table over here, I would like to thank and cannot say enough thanks to my wife, Christina, and who's been there since 2003 when I was still a Badger. And has been through this long trek of graduating as a Badger, making the national team, and being actually cut from an Olympic team, coming back, playing in Europe, and then again trying out for another Olympic team, and making it in 2010 through the as Lizzie and a number of people have pointed out, and even if you didn't point it out, all the great careers, we have challenges that we've had to overcome to be here tonight. So. And then to round out my table, my brother Andy and his wife Samantha. My parents were not able to make the commute down from Alaska, but I know they're here in spirit. And all the sacrifices are as a hockey parent, just don't even need to be said for all the cold rinks they've been in. My Wisconsin parents of Peg and Buck Paulson, their daughter Sis was a defense partner of mine through many years. And she was unable to make it, but my Wisconsin parents were here to represent. My aunt Marsha and Jackie Friesen, Wisconsin UW assistant coach, is here. And then my inaugural class, they were here through the thick and thin, and made those treks with me through Camp Randall, sometimes grunting and not so happy about them, and other times we laughed through them. Jackie McMillan, Kelly Kegley, now Kelly Klein, and Michelle Sikic, now Michelle Gustafson. So I want to thank you all. And ultimately, I want to thank everyone who believed in the program before maybe we even knew to believe in ourselves. And as an individual, we all need someone to believe in us, even when we don't believe in ourselves. So that's what I've learned through my journey. And I want to thank everyone for that. So those are my thank yous. Can't say it enough.
Very well done. Congratulations. Very well
thank
deserved.
You, Carrie,
thank you. Appreciate it. Don't go too far. We're going to bring everybody back up here in a second for that. So. Carrie Wiley. Cheered one more time for all of the inductees, the class of 2015.
We are not quite done. Before we close it out tonight, we'd like to again send out a special thank you to the UW Athletic Department, including the great folks at Video Services and Athletic Communications for helping put the videos together. The voice you heard in those videos was that of Brian Posick, our hockey announcer here at Wisconsin. Want to thank the National W Club, the nominating selection committee, and everybody at the Union South staff for making this event here possible. Again, to the inductees, congratulations to you. And thank each and every one of you for all you mean to the University of Wisconsin. You will be at the game tomorrow, and I know the fans at Camp Randall, it'll be a memory lane for them to see you there because they know how important you are in the history of this program. So that's it's always a thrill for the fans of the first home game, and I hope you can embrace it and take it all in tomorrow. So if we can have all of the inductees, both this year's class and the past classes of the Hall of Famers, if we can have you on stage here, because we need you here and we need me off the stage, because we end this event, per Mike Cernelia, we end it with varsity. So if we can get all of the Hall of Famers on stage, Jim, that means you. Devin, that means you. Come on up. Past Hall of Famers as well, don't be shy. Which means it's a good chance for me to get off the stage. There we go. Of course, a Hall of Famer in his own right. Lead him, Bucky. Get him going. Yep. Photo op here first. Congratulations, class of 2015. Embrace the weekend. Enjoy it. Thank you for being here. Good night. On Wisconsin.